My father decided not to emigrate because he saw no reason for it. Bulgaria had no problem. Of course, they were all very optimistic because, of course, Bulgaria was then became part of the Axis. But a point that I always emphasize that very few people know is the history of Bulgarian Jews. That is one of the great stories of the 1930s, 1940s, or the Nazi days. It was the only country in Europe, with the exception of Denmark, and Denmark did it differently, because in Denmark was sort of kept a small Danish-Jewish population sort of hidden, you might say, by not wearing, I forgot whether they didn't wear Star Davids or everyone wore them, but the fact of the matter, you couldn't very easily find them. In Bulgaria, it was a small 50,000 or so Jews, but had lived there for centuries. These were the people who came there after the Spanish Inquisition, the Canettis and people like that here, who spoke Ladino as well as Bulgarian, but were always part of a minority, oppressed minority, like the Bulgarians, because they were in the Ottomans until relatively recently, and were not discriminated against. So that if there was an anti-Semitism, it was a totally different one from certainly Germany, or totally from the pogroms of Russia or Poland, which just didn't exist in Bulgaria. And there was even a certain amount of intermarriage. And not a single Bulgarian Jew died or was sent to abroad to concentration camps, whereas all around the Balkans, the Romanian Jews, the Greek Jews, Yugoslav, particularly Hungarians, you know, had died by the tens or hundreds of thousands. And that was a very extraordinary story, which is totally ignored. That is only possible when you have a decent population. You cannot do this. You can neither blame nor credit one person. Blaming Hitler for everything that went on in Germany, or crediting King Boris in Bulgaria for everything that went well in the country. You can't do that sort of thing unless the population culturally can accept that or is accustomed to it. And that, I think, is a point that I feel very strongly about and always very pleased about with respect to and proud about Bulgaria. So what then happened in Bulgaria is that after the war, that is, then the communists moved in, the Russians moved in, and therefore Bulgaria always had a wonderful relation historically with the Russians, in contrast to all the other countries around there, because A, spoke a very similar language, Bulgarian Russian, but the Russians originally liberated the Bulgarians from the Turks. So they were always considered the liberators of Bulgaria, and therefore when the Russians moved in, they didn't move in the way they did in other countries. It was sort of a benign, they just moved in as communists taking over, but otherwise it was a very benign relationship between Bulgaria and Russia. And even though it was one of the most Stalinist regimes of communist Eastern Europe, it was an indigenous Stalinist regime, Zhivkov and people like that, rather than imposed on them by the Russians. So in 1947, I think, plus or minus a year, the Bulgarian, by that time communist government, permitted all Bulgarian Jews to emigrate if they wanted to, but only to Israel. And there were some ships that literally left there. And about 80% of the Jewish population of Bulgaria emigrated. The other 20 stayed there. 20% stayed there and was totally integrated, for instance, until very recently, let's say the foreign minister of Bulgaria until the recent election was Jewish, and there are many other important ones. It's interesting that in that country, even though these Jewish families lived there for hundreds of years, you always could tell whether they're Jewish, not from their name, because all the Bulgarian Slavic names, of course, ended like Popov, Dimitrov, endings of OV or EF. The others were always Spanish, Alkali, Meshulam, Canetti, and so on.